Welcome to the SunShot Solar Outreach Partnerships Solar Powering Your Community presentation series. My name is Jason Upal from Meister Consultants Group, and this is Lesson 3, Understanding the Solar Regulatory Landscape. So in this lesson, we're going to be discussing the importance of a strong solar policy, providing an overview of federal solar policy, and discussing some examples of state and local solar policies. So in order to understand why strong solar policy is important for a healthy solar market, let's take a look at some of the latest trends. As we discussed in a previous lesson, the cost of solar has come down significantly over the past decade. And this cost decline has actually accelerated over the past couple of years. Between 2010 and 2012, the cost of solar dropped 52%. All that being said, the cost of solar is still more expensive than the retail price of electricity. And it's for this reason that the solar market, like any energy market, is actually a policy-driven market designed to mitigate costs and increase the value of solar production. And again, as we mentioned in a previous lesson, all energy sources are subsidized, and so every energy market is a policy-driven market, and solar is no different. So there's a wide variety of policies and incentives out there that help to drive the solar market. And today we're going to discuss some of the federal incentives that are out there, as well as provide some examples of state and utility policies. So let's go ahead and start with the federal policies. And with that, we're going to begin with one of the most important incentives, the investment tax credit. Now, this is a tax credit that is valued at 30% of the total installation cost, and it's available to any qualifying solar installation through 2016. Now, because it's a tax credit, the entity that takes that tax credit must be eligible to pay taxes. So this is for for-profit corporations and for residences. But nonprofit entities and public entities are unable to take this tax credit and thus don't receive it. Another important tax benefit is the benefit of accelerated depreciation. This allows a for-profit corporate entity to accelerate the depreciation of the system on its books over the first 6 years, rather than taking it over the entire economic life of the system. While that value of this actual benefit may vary significantly depending upon what the project terms are, the National Renewable Energy Laboratory estimates that the value is around 20 to 25% of the total solar installation. Again, you must have a tax appetite in order to be able to take advantage of this incentive. And so nonprofit entities, as well as public entities, are unable to take this accelerated depreciation. So the third federal incentive I want to talk about is the Qualified Energy Conservation Bond. Now, this is a type of tax credit bond issued by the U.S. Treasury to large local governments, over 100,000 people, or to the state, who then issues it to smaller local governments. So this Qualified Energy Conservation Bond, or QECB, depending upon what this local government structure is, will come from the U.S. Treasury and be issued to the local government. And just like any bond, the local government is going to go ahead and sell those bonds to bondholders in order to raise capital. They can then use that capital to invest in an energy efficiency or renewable energy project that will provide some sort of return. So it's going to go ahead and pay back that principal and some sort of interest on top of that principal. Now, the U.S. Treasury will help to subsidize that interest, such that when the bondholder then goes and sells back their bonds, they see a higher interest rate than what the project is paying back. So this provides projects that may have a lower return on investment to be able to be financed successfully, with the U.S. Treasury helping to cover some of those interest costs. So next up, let's talk about some of the state and utility policies and incentives. Now, obviously, policies and incentives are going to vary widely depending upon what state we're talking about. So we're just going to talk about some of the basic principles of state and utility solar policy and discuss where some of these policies are available. So first up, tax credits. So just as we talked about with the federal government providing tax credits, the state government also provides tax credits on top of that federal investment tax credit. 22 states currently offer some form of tax credit. Some issue only to residential projects. Other may issue to only commercial projects. And some states will issue those tax credits to both. And again, those are added on top of that 30% investment tax credit just to sweeten the deal further. A number of states also offer tax exemptions. So 33 states currently offer some sort of property tax exemption, whether it's a state-level property tax incentive or it's an option for local governments to implement a property tax incentive. If you're interested in learning more about property tax policy, both on the federal level as well as on the state level, I would suggest checking out the Property Tax and Solar PV System report published by the Solar Outreach Partnership. You can find that on our website at solaroutreach.org. So not only do states offer property tax exemptions, but they also offer sales tax exemptions. So for developers going out and actually purchasing solar equipment, they can get the sales tax on top of that equipment exempted in 22 states across the country. Again, some states will offer sales tax exemptions on a state level, and other states may offer a local option for local governments to implement a sales tax exemption. A number of states offer some sort of a direct cash incentive. Sometimes that direct cash incentive will come in form of a rebate, and that incentive may be provided directly through the state government or actually through the utilities themselves. And finally, a number of states out there offer loan programs. There are 32 states that will offer low interest or no interest loans to qualifying solar projects. So if you're interested in learning more about all the policies that we've talked about so far, the Database for State Incentives for Renewable Energy, or DESIRE for short, has a comprehensive resource available online at desireusa.org, where you can find out more about the specific policies available in your state. So the next policy I want to talk about that's incredibly important to the development of a strong solar market is the Renewable Portfolio Standard. Now, taking a step back, the Renewable Portfolio Standard requires utilities to generate a certain amount of their electricity from renewable sources. And some states have gone as far as to require utilities to generate a certain amount of electricity from solar energy sources through what's called a solar carve-out. So because a utility can't determine whether an electron is coming from a fossil fuel facility versus a renewable energy facility, that utility will use an accounting mechanism known as a renewable energy certificate, also sometimes referred to as a renewable energy credit or REC. So to illustrate what this looks like, let's take a traditional fossil fuel power plant. So that power plant is going to go ahead and sell the electron to the utility at a predetermined price. Now, when the renewable energy facility produces electricity, it's going to go ahead and produce the exact same electron, and it's also going to produce a renewable energy credit. Now, in order to meet its compliance requirements, the utility is not only going to purchase the electron, but they're actually going to go ahead and purchase that renewable energy credit from the renewable energy facility. Now, this has the dual benefit of allowing utilities to meet their renewable portfolio standard requirements and providing a second revenue stream to the renewable energy facility, thus incentivizing more renewable energy development. So 29 states in all have adopted some sort of a renewable portfolio standard, which is a legislative requirement for utilities to meet. 8 states have adopted a renewable portfolio goal, which is non-binding. Now, to stress the importance of the renewable portfolio standard, all 10 top solar states in the country have a renewable portfolio standard in place, and 8 out of those 10 have some sort of a solar carve-out or distributed generation provision. And renewable portfolio standards aren't that expensive to implement. In fact, 12 out of 13 states that were surveyed by Lawrence Berkeley National Laboratory were found to only see about a 1.5% increase in retail rates after the renewable portfolio standard was implemented. So the next policy that I want to talk about that's complementary to the renewable portfolio standard is net metering. Now, net metering addresses the variability issue as to when the electricity is being produced by allowing customers to export power to the grid during times of excess generation, and then receiving credits that can be applied to later electricity usage. So let's look at an illustration of exactly how this works. So let's say a customer decides, I want to go ahead and install a solar installation, and they size it such that in the morning, they're producing 100% of their energy needs. Well, as the sun gets stronger throughout the day, they may be actually producing more than they need, and some of that electricity may be going back onto the grid. And so the utility will compensate them for this excess generation through the production of excess credits. Those credits can then be used when the system is no longer producing, let's say at night, even though the customer may actually be using energy. And so this is a great way that a customer can then actually produce 100% of their energy needs even when the sun isn't shining. Now, just like renewable portfolio standards, net metering is important to a strong and healthy solar market. In fact, 93% of distributed PV installations are net metered. and net metering is available in 43 states across the country. So again, if you're interested in learning more about the net metering policy in your state, you can check out the Desire website. Now, there's a policy associated with net metering called virtual net metering. And virtual net metering allows certain types of entities, maybe local governments or universities or large commercial entities, to build large solar installations and send the excess credits to different sites. So let's say, for example, we have a landfill that a local government decides that they want to develop a large solar array on. Well, since they may not have a very large energy load at the landfill, they can actually transfer those credits to many of their different facilities across the city. And the important point to note here is that there is no actual direct connection. So it's not like we're sending wires to all these different locations. We're using the net metering credit administrative process to virtually send that excess generation. Now, virtual net metering is very complicated administratively, and it's not available in every state. So again, if you're interested in learning more, check out the Desire website. You can also find out more about net metering policy through the Freeing the Grid resource available at freeingthegrid.org. Freeing the Grid actually provides a report card for state policy on not only net metering, but actually interconnection policy as well too. Now, the last state and utility policy that I want to talk about is the clean contract or feed-in tariff. And the clean contract is actually a very simple, straightforward concept. Customer decides that they want to go ahead and purchase a solar installation. But rather than using that electricity on site, they actually enter into a contract with the utility to sell all of the electricity to the utility at a predetermined price for a fixed amount of time. So the utility will go ahead and pay the customer for every electron produced. The utility will generally also take all the renewable energy credits associated with that power generation. There are four key parameters associated with clean contracts. The first is that there's a fixed price payment. And this payment is set over a long-term contract, usually around 15 to 20 years. The utility will guarantee that they purchase all of the electricity generated from the solar facility. And the price that they'll purchase it at is set such that the customer receives a reasonable return on investment. Now, clean contracts have been behind many of the largest solar markets in the world, including Germany's solar market. And the reason why they've been so successful is because they create an incredible amount of certainty for the investor in the solar installation. They know how much they're selling the electricity for, they know how long they're selling it for, and they know that no matter how much electricity they produce, it's all going to be sold to the utility. So the risk ends up being very low. So some states have adopted clean contracts. There are also a couple of utilities out there that have adopted clean contracts. And there are actually some municipal utilities that have adopted clean contracts. So if you as a local government are interested in promoting the solar development in your community and you have a relationship with a municipal utility, I would suggest checking out a clean contract as a strong solar policy to drive growth in your market. Now that concludes lesson 3, Understanding the Solar Regulatory Landscape. Next up, we have Introduction to Solar Project Finance.